Hey everybody, and welcome to another JASP tutorial video. I'm excited to be back here, and today we are going to do a factorial ANOVA through the ANOVA menu. And just a quick reminder, I am using the current preview build of JASP Statistics, JASP 0.10.1. And so let's get right into it. Okay, I have pulled up the data file that we're going to work with today. You may be familiar if you've seen my other videos. This is data that I've been using for many of my tutorial videos to go through the examples. This is real human data from about 5 years ago. Excuse me. And let's jump right into it. So let's go to ANOVA. And if you're familiar with the previous episode, if you've seen that, I'm going to go ahead and link it in the top right corner of this video if you want to take a look. This is sort of a pair video with that, where I did a one-way ANOVA. And for a factorial ANOVA, you are going to go to the same menu options, the same analysis option here to do a factorial ANOVA. Now this is, it's important that you recognize this particular ANOVA is for between subject variables or independent group variables. Okay, so if you're doing a factorial ANOVA with between subject variables, all of them are between subjects, and you can use this ANOVA. If at least one of them is a within subjects or a within groups variable, then you will need to use the repeated measure ANOVAs, and that's going to be in a future episode. So we're going to stick with the between subjects ANOVAs here, and I clicked it again and it brought up a second ANOVA dialog box, but we're going to go ahead and just use the one. Okay? And so for the dependent variable, actually, before I go into the various pieces of the model, please check the other video for deep discussions on many of these options down here. So I'm not going to go into too much depth other than what the factorial ANOVA brings to the model, the analysis, which are interactions, and the extra stuff you can do with interaction terms. So I'm going to go ahead and get started with this. So as I said, the dependent variable, I'm going to go ahead and make it the incongruent accuracy score, like we did in the previous video. And for my fixed factors, I'm going to go ahead and throw in trace condition. And so the trace condition was either fluent tracing, disfluent tracing, or no tracing at all. And then the other option I'm going to do is gender. And this was coded as male-female. Okay? And so you can already see that the model has produced the source table, where I have a line for my main effect of trace condition, a line for my main effect of gender, and a line for my interaction term, which is trace condition by gender. That's what this asterisk here means. It is the interaction term, and so it's the variable 1 by variable 2, and then we get Fs for all of those and associated p-values from our F distribution. Now, one of the things that you can now do in the model is make sure that you have all of the model terms. I could take out the interaction term if I wanted to, but of course, that would be silly. In a factorial, you want to assess the interaction term. Okay, we put it back in there. You see trace condition by gender. All right, so that's model. Assumption checks are essentially no difference between a one-way ANOVA and a factorial ANOVA, one single test. And then we can get the QQ plots of residuals. Residuals look fine. So we can go ahead and skip that. If you wanted to know more about contrast, please see the previous ANOVA video where I go into detail. You can get contrasts for your two independent factors here. Post hoc tests, we can move trace condition over. We can move gender over, and we can move the interaction term over, and we end up with our post hoc comparisons. Again, going into detail with all of these would be in the previous video. We can get our confidence intervals, our effect size, and we can determine what corrections we want. Tukey, Chaffé, Bonferroni are the, I would say, main three. Of course, Holm and Sydak are acceptable as well. And in each of these cases, you end up with a corrected p-value along with a Cohen's d, which is the effect size here. It will give you two separate tables for those pairwise comparisons, one for trace condition. The post hoc comparison for gender obviously is only a single t-test. And so we have a t-test value here. Tukey, Chaffé, and Bonferroni in this case are all the same p-value because there were no multiple comparisons for that. And this is the pairwise comparisons for the interaction term, and so you can see 1-1 by 2-1, 1-1 by 3-1, 1-1 by 1-2, and the commas here represent the cell that your 3x2 table makes. So there are six different comparisons that you can, well, excuse me, five different comparisons, because it wouldn't make a comparison to yourself, degrees of freedom. So there are six cells, five different comparisons that you can make across those cells. And of course, they do not duplicate. From this first one, as you can see, 2-2 only has 3-2 as a pair for testing, okay? And so these are cell pairwise comparisons. I will be talking about simple effects in a little bit, which are more appropriate for assessing whether an interaction is something that you can describe a little bit better, because an interaction is a complex effect, and so you need to break it down when you write about it in your results sections. Descriptive plots, now, because I'm doing a factorial, we can show you what the line graph looks like in JASP here. So I'm going to go ahead and make a two dot or two column horizontal axis. So my x-axis is just going to be gender. And so I'm going to have three lines. So I'm going to put gender as the x-axis, separate lines as trace condition. And if I had a third factor, if I had a three-way design, I could put the third one here into separate plots. And so I would get however many plots for levels. And then I can get my error bars, and I'm going to go ahead and put the standard error bars. And here we have three lines with three different ends. And so we have males as one, twos as females, and we have our scale again. This graph would not really be all that appropriate for APA style, because the scale of the graph is a little too loose here. 0 to 1 doesn't really give you an indication of where, you know, half is, 0.5. So, I mean, you could just clearly, you can just sort of ballpark the pattern that the figure gives you, which is males are better in trace 1 condition and trace 3 condition than females, but they all convert, let me back up. Males are better in the fluent and control condition than they are than the males that were in the disfluent condition. But for females, they're all pretty converging, or they're all converging on this general average over here. there's a lot of overlap between those means. So that's descriptive plots with a factorial design. You can get additional options. You can get marginal mean tables, and I'm going to go ahead and use shift to click all of them over, and I get the marginal means. And so if you want to make your own graph, you would graph these marginal means. The marginal means are appropriate for factorial designs because you would want to use this table, the traced condition by gender table, to plot those cell means. These means here are what are shown in this plot. But if you just wanted to do a graph with gender, you can use these means. If you wanted to just do cell trace condition, you can just use these means. And you would have three options for plots there. And we can get descriptive statistics. I'm going to go ahead and leave that out in this particular video. Again, you can see the previous episode's ANOVA where I go through detail. Now, the last thing I want to point out for this video, this shorter video for Factorial ANOVAs, is the Simple Main Effects screen. Now, this one might be a little different than what you're used to if you use SPSS, for example. There's a different way to calculate simple effects. I think JASP makes it a little bit easier. A little bit simpler to figure out simple effects that are, you know, potentially less cumbersome than these post hoc comparisons, because this is tables big. It's a lot of information, and so I just want to run simple effects. If I have a significant interaction, if my p-value for the interaction term is less than 0.05, then I'm going to go ahead and run simple effects to determine what is directing the interaction, what's causing the interaction. So you would choose one of your factors to be the simple effect factor, and then you would use the other one as the moderator. Now, if you had a third factor in here, if you had a three-way, then you would use the third factor here as the second moderator. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and put gender in as my simple effect factor and trace condition as my moderator factor, and I'll show you that in just a second. And here it pops in just after the marginal means, but before the descriptives plot. Okay, and so we have simple main effects for gender. And why I put simple effect factor as gender is this does a one-way ANOVA for your moderator. And why I put gender here is that there are only two levels. So this one-way ANOVA for this F-test is actually T-squared. This F here is T-squared because I only have two. If you have two levels and you do a one-way ANOVA, it's the same result as getting T-squared. So if I were to do a T-test for males versus females just in the trace condition, if I square that T-value, I end up getting this F-value here. And so there is a specific reason why you might want to choose a particular factor or independent variable to put in as the simple main effects, just to simplify the output for the simple main effects. And so this is the trace level condition 1, which is the fluent. It's males compared to females in just that condition. And so we can look through and we go across and we end up with, you know, a p of 0.054. Oh, that's marginal. What are we going to do? Well, you know, in this age of p-hacking, we're going to leave that as non-significant. It's approaching. It's kind of there. But you know what? We don't have the power probably to detect that effect. And if we go up here to the overall interaction effect, you can see that the p-value is plainly not significant, okay? So we go back to our significant, our simple effects, excuse me, and we can look at just the disfluent condition here, males versus females, and we end up with an F-test for that. And then for the control condition, males and females, we end up with an F-test for that. So that's a good way to determine what is driving the interaction. What of the factors is dependent on the other factors. Okay, and then you can describe this test in a couple of different ways. Okay, in your write-up. Okay, so that's the last thing I wanted to talk about for factorial ANOVAs. This is specifically for between subject designs. Both factors or all the factors in the factorial are all between subjects. That's what you can use the ANOVA menu for. Otherwise, if you have at least one, you'll have to stay tuned for the episode where I talk about repeated measures. Please leave your comments and feedback down below. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.